Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is Tom Steckschulde, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled, Behold the Mighty Dinosaur. Your professor is John Kricher, professor of biology at Wheaton College. Professor Kricher is a fellow in the American Ornithologists Union and past president of both the Association of Field Ornithologists and the Wilson Ornithological Society. His interest in dinosaurs has taken him to virtually every major museum collection, and he has hunted dinosaurs in Connecticut, Colorado, Utah, Wyoming, Montana, and along the Red Deer River in Alberta. He teaches about dinosaurs in his classes and has amassed a large private collection of dinosaur models. He resides with his wife, Martha Vaughn, on Cape Cod. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin, Behold the Mighty Dinosaur, Lecture 1. What is, or was, a dinosaur? And now, Professor Kricher.
Behold the Mighty Dinosaur, famous in prehistoric lore. Those are the opening lines of a poem by an author named Bert Leston Taylor. The poem was titled The Riddle of the Dinosaur, and it was first published in 1910. But I read it when I read a book called The Dinosaur Book in the mid-1950s. And that was a book authored by a person named Edwin H. Colbert, who was at the American Museum of Natural History in New York. Oh, I had already read a few things about dinosaurs. I read a book for children called All About Dinosaurs by Roy Chapman Andrews. Later in this lecture series, you'll hear all about Roy Chapman Andrews. I've been hooked on dinosaurs since the 1950s, books, models, films, and most importantly, seeing them in museums. I've even wandered around out west where dinosaur bones are found and looked for them myself. The dinosaur that was featured in the poem is a dinosaur named Stegosaurus, and I'm sure you've heard of it. Everybody's heard of Stegosaurus. That's the big cumbersome thing that had pachyderm-like legs, a hunchback, a tiny little minuscule head, but most importantly, and the way you'd recognize it, is by the fact that it had a double row of great big bony triangular plates running the length of its back, and its tail was tipped in four very long spikes. It was a strange-looking creature, and it's one that most kids learn about when they first start learning about dinosaurs. One of the funny things about Stegosaurus is that when scientists first looked at its skull, they realized that this creature that weighed maybe 2 tons had a brain about the size of a walnut. And then when they looked at its backbone, they found that in the area where its hips are, the nerve cord seemed to get larger. It was as though it had a second brain in its hip. That's what led to the poem. So let me read the poem for you. It's about the two brains of the Stegosaurus. Behold the mighty dinosaur, famous in prehistoric lore, not only for his power and length, but for his intellectual strength. You will observe from these remains, the creature had 2 sets of brains, one in his head, the usual place, the other at its spinal base. Thus he could reason a priori as well as a posteriori. No problem bothered him a bit, he made both head and tail of it, so wise was he, so wise and solemn. Each thought filled just a spinal column. If one brain found the pressure strong, it passed a few ideas along. If something slipped its forward mind, 'twas rescued by the one behind. And if in error he was caught, he had a saving afterthought. As he thought twice before he spoke, he had no judgment to revoke, for he could think without congestion upon both sides of every question. O gaze upon this model beast! Defunct 10 million years at least. Well, it's been defunct for a lot longer than 10 million years. That's one thing that Bert Leston Taylor got wrong. And the other thing he got wrong is it didn't have 2 brains. But it certainly was an odd creature nonetheless, and that's what appeals to us about dinosaurs. They're big, they're scary, they're odd-looking, and we tend to think of them as dumb. Not just a little dumb, but really dumb. And, of course, they're all extinct. They lived millions of years ago when the world was full of ferns and volcanoes. Why do dinosaurs fascinate us? We can't go out and see them, or can we? One of the reasons, maybe, that children get so interested in dinosaurs is they like to say the names. Think about it. Dinosaurs are about the only animals in our lives that we refer to by their scientific or Latinized names. We don't call a blue jay Stellariana cyanocita, we call it a blue jay. But we don't call a stegosaurus a roofed lizard or a roofed reptile, that's what its name means, we call it a stegosaurus. Incidentally, the name stegosaurus refers to the plates on the back of the animal. Even the name dinosaur is interesting to say. Most people know that the name dinosaur comes from the Latin for terrible lizard or fearfully great reptile. Think about some of the names of other dinosaurs. I'll bet you've heard of Triceratops. Triceratops means three-horned face. That was the big rhinoceros-like dinosaur that had two horns poking above each eye and one horn on its nose. And then there's Apatosaurus, probably better known to many people as Brontosaurus. That's actually a dinosaur that was named twice. We'll talk about that. Apatosaurus means deceptive reptile. Brontosaurus, on the other hand, means thunder reptile. That's a better name, but unfortunately we have to call it Apatosaurus. I'll explain why. Then there's Diplodocus. Bet you've heard of Diplodocus, one of the long-necked, long-tailed dinosaurs. Looks sort of like an elephant in the middle and a snake on each end. Diplodocus means double beam. It's a reference to the peculiar kind of vertebrae Diplodocus had on its tail, vertebrae that may have actually helped it rear up. Then there's Allosaurus. Allosaurus the meat-eater, the big meat-eater of the Jurassic. Allosaurus means simply strange or other reptile. You wouldn't think it was strange if you saw it. You'd just think it was ferocious and you'd run the other way. One of the ones I like the best is called Anatotitan. Anatotitan was a great big duck-billed dinosaur of the Cretaceous times. Anatotitan means big duck. And then there's the one I like perhaps the best of all, Pachycephalosaurus. It's a fun name to say. Kids love it. Pachycephalosaurus translates to thick-headed reptile. This was the dinosaur that had inches and inches of solid bone and a tiny little brain. Velociraptor, star of Jurassic Park. Raptor means thief. Velosa means swift. This is the swift thief. And the co-star of Jurassic Park, Tyrannosaurus rex, the king of tyrant reptiles. Most dinosaurs are Latinized in the masculine, but a couple of them are Latinized in the feminine, and for good reason. We're going to talk about a paleontologist named Jack Horner, and Jack Horner has found an entire nesting ground of a dinosaur in Montana. He's found the nests, he's found the eggs, he's even found the babies. Appropriately enough, he named it Mayasaura, not Mayasaurus, Mayasaura. That's feminine, and it means good mother lizard. The only other feminine name for a dinosaur I could find is Lielinosaura. You probably haven't heard of that one. That's an Australian dinosaur, a pretty small one, and it was named after a little girl named Llewellyn Rich, whose parents, Tom and Patricia, described the little 10-inch dinosaur. That's right, if you find a dinosaur, you get to name it, and if you want to, you can name it for your kid. Children have always thought of themselves as being a bit empowered by knowing dinosaurs. It's something they can learn and something they can know that their parents don't know. But their parents try to teach them about dinosaurs. And what assumptions do we make about these creatures? When we think about them, what do we think about them? Well, probably most of us think dinosaurs, well, they were all huge, but not Lielinosaura and not Velociraptor. We probably think many of them were swamp dwellers, that they were bizarre-looking, dangerous, dumb. And, of course, we probably think all of them are extinct. How accurate are these assumptions, though? Well, let's look at them a little bit more closely. Were all dinosaurs huge? The answer to that is some were. Brachiosaurus, for instance, which means arm reptile because it had such long forelegs. If a brachiosaurus were to stretch its neck the full length and stand up on its legs as tall as it could, It could look directly into a six-story high window. Its estimated weight, although weights of dinosaurs are really difficult to determine with any great precision, is 75 tons. That's a big animal. Tyrannosaurus rex. Everybody knows what a Tyrannosaurus rex looks like from Jurassic Park. T-Rex was about 40 feet long, estimated weight anywhere from 5 to 7 tons, females weighing a bit more than males. I'll talk about Tyrannosaurus in a lecture later. That would put it to be about the same size as an African elephant in terms of its weight, or two white rhinoceroses. By any measure, T-Rex was huge. Stegosaurus, the dinosaur I talked about earlier, is estimated to have weighed about 2.5 tons. That's about the same as a white rhino. Triceratops, the three-horned face, which sort of looked like a rhino, weighed maybe, up to 6 tons. Again, roughly twice the weight of a modern rhino. But think about this. The largest mammal ever to walk the Earth, and notice I said to walk the Earth, was a creature named Indricotherium, found in Mongolia. It's no longer alive. It was a creature of the Oligocene some 20 million years ago. It weighed about 15 tons. That's roughly the same as what a Diplodocus weighed. But the largest vertebrate ever to live, at least as far as we know, and you're probably familiar with this, is the blue whale. They're alive today, and female blue whales can weigh up to 150 tons, which is about 2 brachiosaurus worth of whale. A sperm whale weighs up to 45 tons, more than virtually all the other dinosaurs, except possibly the very largest. So yes, there were a lot of large dinosaurs, but consider this. There was a dinosaur named Compsognathus. These are the little compies of several of the Jurassic Park films. The average weight estimated for a Compsognathus was maybe 7 or 8 pounds. I have a cat that weighs twice that much. Then there was a dinosaur named Ornitholestes, means bird robber. It was a little predatory dinosaur of the Jurassic, estimated to weigh about 30 pounds. And speaking of little predatory dinosaurs, Velociraptor, unlike the big version of it that was shown in Jurassic Park, the actual Velociraptor only weighed about 33 pounds. Still, that's 33 pounds of animal you don't want to really get close to. Then there's a little dinosaur named Microraptor. That's found in Mongolia. We'll talk about that when we talk about the relationship between dinosaurs and birds, but Microraptors only weighed about 8 ounces. What about bizarre? Can we really put that label on dinosaurs? Yeah, I think we probably can, at least for some of them. I don't know of anything that reminds me of a Stegosaurus except a Stegosaurus. That's pretty bizarre. And related to Stegosaurus is a group of animals named Ankylosaurs. We'll meet those too. They look like little armored tanks, except they weren't so little. The biggest of them got to be 20 feet long. They were so heavily covered with bone that even their eyelids had bone. That's a lot of bone. Then there are the long-necked dinosaurs, the Diplodocus, the Brachiosaurus, the Apatosaurus, with the long tails and the long necks. Diplodocus may have even had a tail that could crack like a whip. That's pretty bizarre. And the duck-billed dinosaurs, the things that you'll learn about called hadrosaurs, the things like the mosasaur that I mentioned just earlier. These animals had big mouths with up to 2,000 teeth that could grind up plants better than any cow can today. So I guess they qualify as being a bit bizarre. But if I had to name which is the most bizarre, I'd probably say it's the therizinosaurs. Now maybe you haven't heard of the therizinosaurs. They haven't worked them into Jurassic Park yet. But a therizinosaur was a kind of bipedal dinosaur that kind of looked like a duck with a pot belly, with a head that was way too small for its body, and with claws that were way too long for its hands. A therizinosaur had claws that ranged in the neighborhood of 2 to 3 feet long. The animal itself stood about 15 to 20 feet tall. And as near as anyone can tell, it was a strange, waddling plant eater of Mongolia in the late Cretaceous time, nearly at the end of the time of the dinosaurs. That was a very strange-looking creature. Were dinosaurs actually dangerous? Oh, yeah. Dinosaurs were really dangerous. It would have made no more sense to literally walk up to a herd of apatosaurs and hadrosaurs than it would be to wander around in a herd of American bison or Cape buffalo in Africa. You'd probably get trampled. and approaching a Utah raptor, or for that matter, a couple of velociraptors, would make about as much sense as walking up and shaking paws with a lion or a tiger. As for approaching a T-Rex, well, that's just plain nuts. It would eat you. Were dinosaurs really dumb? That's an interesting question. They appear to have been. They have pretty small brains. In fact, interestingly enough, there's a dinosaur called Camarasaurus. That was once named Morosaurus. Morosaurus? It's taken from moron. It meant foolish lizard. Fortunately, that name didn't stick. Well, we can look at dinosaurs in a somewhat objective way with regard to their potential intellect by looking at something called the encephalization quotient. Now, that's a fancy term for the fact that you can simply estimate the weight of the brain relative to the body mass. This is not the same, I hasten to add, as IQ. We don't sit dinosaurs in a room and have them solve puzzles. Now, the encephalization quotient is based only on the estimated volume of their brain relative to their mass of their bodies. And there's much variation among dinosaurs, and poor Stegosaurus, with the brain the size of a walnut, does not have the smallest encephalization quotient of any dinosaur. That honor goes to the long-necked sauropods like Brachiosaurus, Apatosaurus, and Diplodocus. Their pathetic little encephalization quotient is only 0.2. They have very, very little brain mass in relation to body weight. As for a stegosaur, well, it comes out to be about three times that big. It's got an encephalization quotient of 0.6, and an ankylosaur is pretty much the same, 0.55. As for T-Rex, well, it was a predator, and predators are usually smarter than herbivores. Lions, for instance, are probably smarter than wildebeest. The T-Rex encephalization quotient, depending on the brain you use to measure it, was somewhere between 1.0 and 1.9. And as for Maniraptors and Dromaeosaurs, which are fancy names for things like the Velociraptors and Deinonychus, which we'll hear about later, they had encephalization quotients quite comparable to modern birds at around 5.8. One dinosaur in that particular group even had an encephalization quotient slightly above 6. That makes it pretty bright. How do I know this? Well, let's look at some familiar mammals and compare them. A squirrel. They're pretty smart. They figure out how to get to my bird feeder. They have encephalization quotients of about 1.1. A bottlenose dolphin. We all know that Flipper was smart. Encephalization quotient of 5.6, slightly smaller than that of the largest encephalization quotient measured for a dinosaur. Chimpanzees are smart, but their encephalization quotients are about 2.5. So where are we on that scale, human beings? Over 7. Human beings are anywhere from 7 to 7.5. We're about 37 times better brain than an Apatosaurus. So it's not really accurate to say that all dinosaurs are dumb. Some of them were very comparable to modern animals with regard to what their potential abilities to learn and to react would be. Now, all dinosaurs are extinct. We certainly know that. There are no T-Rexes, no Apatosaurs, no Brachiosaurs, no Triceratops. They're all gone. Part of the dinosaur mystique has always been their extinction. What caused it? Why are they all gone? That's part of the reason they're so much fun. There are huge monsters, but all is well because they're not here anymore, and we can fantasize about them without worrying about them. But as you'll learn in the coming lectures, they may not be all gone. Modern birds, at least in the eyes of most evolutionary biologists, are dinosaurs. Just as cats are related to extinct saber-toothed cats, and just as modern elephants are related to extinct mammoths and mastodons, birds are related to extinct T-Rexes and velociraptors. So, if you look at it that way, there are about 10,000 species of dinosaurs that currently inhabit the world, about double the number of existing mammal species. Birds, taken together, represent, however, far less anatomical and ecological diversity than we saw in the full range of dinosaurs that once populated the Earth. Imagine a dense evolutionary bush with each of its branches representing the genealogy of one group of dinosaurs. Then imagine pruning that bush such that only one of those branches remains, all the others cut, all the others gone. That's the evolutionary history of dinosaurs, and that one remaining branch is that of the modern birds. Birds are wonderful and colorful and interesting, but they're not sauropods, they're not stegosaurs, ceratopsians, or duckbills, and all of the other wondrous creatures you're going to hear about in this lecture series. Dinosaurs stay interesting. The term dinomania was invented when Jurassic Park was released in 1993. People began collecting dinosaur models, going to see dinosaur movies, and the Discovery Channel has kind of made a small industry of shows about dinosaurs, probably the most famous of which is the British Broadcasting Company series Walking with Dinosaurs. What's more interesting is that dinosaurs have created their own celebrities among the scientists who study them. Now, you have to understand, there aren't a lot of people who study dinosaurs. You have to have an awfully big laboratory for that and a lot of money to excavate bones that weigh many tons. And so the number of people who actually spend their entire lives studying dinosaurs is fairly limited. But some of them are very bright and some of them are very articulate, and they've been seen repeatedly on the various shows about dinosaurs. Perhaps you've heard the name Robert Bakker or Bob Bakker. You'll hear more about him. I've already mentioned Jack Horner, the man who discovered the Mesozoic. And then there's Phil Curry, a Canadian expert on T-Rex, Mike Novacek and Mark Norell from the American Museum of Natural History, Paul Serino from the University of Chicago, and Dale Russell, and this is by no means all of them. But these scientists have appeared repeatedly on shows about dinosaurs, and many children who study dinosaurs know their names. Okay, so we've established that dinosaurs were not all big, they weren't all dumb, bizarre, and they're not all extinct. But what exactly were they? What actually was a dinosaur? Well, that's the subject for this entire course, but I think it's a good idea to give you a few clues right now. Let's start by asking the question, what would a dinosaur remind you mostly of? Would a dinosaur remind you of, say, a crocodile? What about a frog? How about a seagull? What about something like a bear? What kind of animal exists today most like a dinosaur? As you'll learn in this course, that's not such an easy question to answer. If dinosaurs were to remind you a lot of crocodiles, maybe it's their physical appearance. They have, at least some of them, a kind of crocodile-like face. But what if you took the crocodile's body temperature and compared it with the body temperature of a bear and the body temperature of a dinosaur? What if the dinosaur's body temperature was as warm as the bear's and considerably warmer than the crocodile? What if you watched a crocodile all day and it hardly moved around at all, but on the other hand, you watched a bear and it was pretty animated, and then you watched a dinosaur? Would it tend to behave like a crocodile, or would it tend to behave like a bear? And why a seagull? Would a dinosaur remind you at all of a seagull? Well, maybe, if it was feathered. Some of them may have been. What about a frog? No, that's the odd one out. Probably not many dinosaurs would remind you of frogs. Let's just introduce a few basics now, and then these will be revisited in later lectures in the course. First, a dinosaur is a kind of animal called a vertebrate. So are you. I'll use the term vertebrate from time to time. That's a term that refers to the vertebral column, the bony column, that makes up the basis for your skeleton. Now, things like cockroaches and lobsters are not vertebrates because they don't have this kind of internal skeleton of bone. So a vertebrate is an animal with a skeleton of bone. And dinosaurs are vertebrates, humans are vertebrates, and things like fish, reptiles and amphibians, and birds are vertebrates. Now, what's a reptile? We'll use the term reptile pretty loosely throughout this course because a reptile is an animal. We normally think of it as a crocodile, a snake, a lizard, but you'll learn that dinosaurs were reptiles too. But they were a unique kind of reptile. They weren't the same as reptiles that are turtles, crocodiles, snakes, or lizards. What makes a reptile in the modern sense is that they have scales and claws. Some of them give live birth, but most of them lay eggs. Those that do lay eggs, and those that give live births, all reptiles, just like all birds and mammals, are capable of reproducing on land, outside of water. That's a big deal. But dinosaurs may not have had scales. In fact, they didn't. We have skin impressions from dinosaurs, and even though dinosaurs are a form of reptile, they don't have scales. All modern reptiles, crocodiles, turtles, snakes, and lizards, are what we call cold-blooded. That's a term you're going to hear about more. A more technical term for it is ectothermic, but dinosaurs may not have been ectothermic. That will be a big subject of our focus. So if dinosaurs are reptiles, they were certainly different kinds of reptiles from crocodiles, snakes, lizards, and turtles. And you need to get comfortable with that idea, because we're going to be talking about that at some length. That's a very big deal in understanding dinosaurs. But what made them different? What actually was a dinosaur? How would you define them? Well, bear in mind what it is that we anatomist types have to work with, and that's anatomy. Dinosaurs leave us a record of their bones, something that we call the fossil record. We'll talk about that in another lecture. But when we look at dinosaur fossils, when we look at their skeletons, we learn that they have upright posture. That makes them quite different from crocodiles and lizards and turtles. You have upright posture. If you have a dog, it has upright posture. If you ride a horse, it has upright posture. If you look at an ostrich, it has upright posture. Dinosaurs had unique hips and they had unique ankles that made them capable of standing upright, supporting their body weight in a most efficient manner. Part of the reason for this is another characteristic that dinosaurs had, and that is at least three, and usually more, vertebrae that connected their backbone onto their hips. Oh, you're going to hear a lot about dinosaur hips in this course. And it's important, because hips hold up the body. That's really the fulcrum for the whole body. Dinosaurs had amazing hips, hips much more similar to yours, incidentally, than they are to the hips of crocodiles or lizards. Now, just for the record, let's talk for a moment about what other kinds of vertebrates are, so that when we hear these groups, we'll know what we mean. A vertebrate, as I said, is an animal with a backbone. So what kinds of animals have those things? Well, there's one big group called fish. We're not going to have much to say about fish in this course, but we do need to talk about them in at least one lecture, because fish came before all other kinds of vertebrates, and so it is from fish that all other kinds of vertebrates eventually evolved. And we'll talk about that connection between fish and vertebrates that are land-dwelling. Then another kind of vertebrate group is called amphibians. Amphibians we typically think of as frogs and salamanders, what makes them different. Well, amphibians are tetrapods. That means they have four legs. Instead of going around with fins, which is what fish do in the water, amphibians go about on land using actual legs with toes, and so they kind of walk. Now, amphibians, unlike reptiles, don't have scaly, dry skin. They have skin that doesn't have scales or claws, and it's kept very moist. This is because amphibians have to be in water at least part of the time. In fact, in order for them to reproduce, they have to be able to put their eggs in some kind of aquatic situation. Sometimes it's in water, sometimes they're more innovative, like when frogs lay eggs in tropical bromeliads, which are suspended up in the rainforest canopy. In any case, amphibians don't lay eggs with hard shells, and that makes them quite different from other things like reptiles, mammals, and birds. So one group of fish gave rise to amphibians, and then amphibians eventually evolved into the first of the reptiles, which we'll hear about in a later lecture. I told you what reptiles are, at least in the modern sense. They're cold-blooded or ectothermic animals, such as snakes and lizards with dry skin. What about mammals? Well, you're a mammal, so you should know what that is. Most people think about mammals as being creatures with hair, some kind of fur covering them. People also associate mammary glands with mammals. Mammals are unique in that they suckle their young with milk. Dinosaurs didn't do that. Dinosaurs are not mammals. Keep remembering that dinosaurs were reptiles, but they were a unique kind of reptile. Now, we can't look in the fossil record to find hair and mammary glands. We can only look at skeletons. So the other thing you should know is that mammals have different kinds of skeletons from dinosaurs. We see very many differences between a mammalian skeleton and a dinosaur skeleton. I could teach a student in 15 minutes to tell the difference between a dinosaur skeleton and a mammal skeleton. It's very easy to do. But one of the characteristics mammals do have, which may be something shared with dinosaurs, is that mammals are very active. Mammals are warm-blooded, or as we call it, endothermic. So they have very high metabolisms, they run and scurry around, and that's a characteristic that dinosaurs may have shared. What about birds? Well, birds are like mammals in the following way. They're also endothermic, they have high metabolisms. They're covered with feathers instead of hair, but it amounts to the same thing. Hair keeps you warm and feathers keep you warm. And birds are additionally unique in that they can fly. Some of their feathers are adapted to allow them to fly by forming wings. So birds and mammals both have characteristics of high activity levels, and they are very upright in their postures, rather like dinosaurs. So dinosaurs, in many respects, as you'll learn, have much more in common with birds and mammals than they do with traditional reptiles, even though dinosaurs are reptiles. But what you have to consider, and this is where we're going to get to by the end of the course, dinosaurs were unique. They're a unique group of animals. They don't really fit into any of the standard groups of vertebrates. And in fact, birds, really, as you'll learn, are a form of dinosaur. And finally, when did dinosaurs live? I'm going to be talking about this a lot. Dinosaurs lived at a time called the Mesozoic Era. The Mesozoic Era began 248 million years ago. That seems like a long time ago. And it ended 65 million years ago. It's divided into three periods based on patterns in the fossil record. The first of those periods is called the Triassic period. The second is called the Jurassic period. Yes, you've heard of Jurassic Park. And the third is called the Cretaceous periods. Dinosaurs really flourished during the Jurassic and Cretaceous period, but they evolved in Triassic period. Dinosaurs were common for at least 160 million years. They were on Earth far longer than humans have been. At the earliest, humans evolved around 3.5 million years ago. They weren't quite human then, but they were starting. And Homo sapiens, our species, has arguably been around for at most about 500,000 or more years. So if you look at hominids, the group to which humans belong, the human family tree, we've been around for a grand total of about 0.077% of Earth's history. We are real neophytes. 95% of Earth's history happened prior to the dinosaurs. Let me give you an analogy, which I think would be a good thing to keep in mind during this course. This will give you a sense of the history of life on Earth and where the dinosaurs fit and where we humans fit. I want you to stretch your arms out to your sides as fully as they can go. And then I want you to look at the tips of your right fingers. Suppose the tips of your right fingers are the starting point for the Earth itself, the very origin of our planet. Our planet is 4.5 billion years old. The solar system is 4.6 billion years old. So in the span of your arms, we're going to cover those 4.6 billion years. Now, if you are wearing a watch on your left hand, go from the tips of your right fingers across your right hand and your right forearm and your right upper arm across your chest to your left upper arm to your left forearm. And when you get to your watch band on your left wrist, that is the beginning of time when there were multicellular animals, things like cockroaches and fish, stuff like that. Up to that point, they didn't exist. But from the time you left your right hand all the way across your arms and chest, the world fundamentally was composed of nothing more than living bacteria and one-celled creatures. It was only by the time you get to your watch band that you get multicellular animals. Now look at your left hand and look at your fingers. If you look at the first two joints of your fingers, look at the middle finger, that's an easy one to use, that's the age of dinosaurs relative to the entire age of the Earth. Those two digits in your middle finger represent the proportion of time dinosaurs were on the planet. Now look at that last digit on your middle finger, that very last little digit. That represents approximately the age of mammals, the age since the end of the dinosaurs 65 million years ago. And if perchance your fingernail should protrude out ever so slightly, that's all of human history in proportion to the age of the Earth. So this is the geologic time that we're dealing with in this course, and we'll be talking about the Mesozoic era. In this course, I plan to take you back to how dinosaurs were first discovered and how we've come to understand them to the degree that we have. Do we know now everything we're ever going to know about them? No, of course not. Each year we learn more and more about dinosaurs. But still we know a lot. And to begin with, we're going to talk about how we find dinosaurs. Where do we look? Where do we find their remains? And then we'll go on from there to the history of dinosaurs, the discoveries, and how we've come to know them as well as we have. But in our next lecture, we're going to start by figuring out how we look for dinosaurs.
After listening to Lecture 1, a student posed this question to Professor Kricher. Why were dinosaurs able to grow so quickly and so large?
The question of why some dinosaurs, by no means all, but some dinosaurs got to be as large as they did to real behemoth proportions is really a mystery to a lot of paleontologists. But one thing is certain, they did really get to be that size, and so that demands some explanation. One possible reason is that they simply may have been able to consume food rapidly enough to grow fast enough, and they may have had enough pressure on them from predators that being able to grow fast literally made them big enough that they never had to worry about predators. If you watch things like gazelles, for instance, which are modern average-sized mammals, they have a lot to worry about from lions and cheetahs, depending on their age. But if you watch elephants, they have very little to worry about with regard to lions and cheetahs, even baby ones. Baby ones are protected by their parents, and their parents are simply so large that size alone protects them from attack by these predators. So it may be that in the evolution between predator and prey of dinosaurs, that stimulated at least some of them to evolve larger sizes because those larger sizes adapted them to reduce the probability of predation. Remember, the predators were awfully large too. Why didn't some mammals grow to the size of dinosaurs? Well, very few did. There's one large rhinoceros species, Indricotherium, that is estimated to have weighed at least 20 tons. That's the largest land mammal anybody knows about, and that was comparable in size to a dinosaur. But the point's well taken that, by and large, mammals are a bit smaller than dinosaurs. But you might be surprised. Go to the American Museum of Natural History or some other place that has a good dinosaur collection, and aside from the big long-necked sauropods, you'll find that for the most part, dinosaur sizes compare fairly closely with the sizes of mammals. Things as big as rhinoceroses, for example, elephants, and that sort of thing, are not very much smaller than some of the dinosaurs. In fact, they're larger than many. But one of the things about evolution is that it's predictable only up to a point. Some things go off on trajectories that other things simply don't go off on. Now, mammal evolution is as old as dinosaur evolution, in fact, older, but throughout most of the Mesozoic period, mammals remained small and hardly evolved at all. It's only from 65 million years to the present that really big mammals have occurred, and so maybe we'll see bigger mammals, who's to say?
This ends Lecture 1. Behold the mighty dinosaur. Lecture 2, Digging Up Dinos.
In our last lecture, we talked about dinosaurs, and I'll bet you were sort of envisioning them in your mind's eye. You could see Stegosaurus with its waddling body and its big plates, and you probably had the image of T-Rex in your mind from Jurassic Park. But how did we get there? How did we go out and find dinosaurs and recreate them? What kind of evidence is there that they actually existed? If I told you to go out and find me a dinosaur, and I wouldn't let you show me a bird, how would you do it? Dinosaurs first evolved as long ago as 230 million years, and all except the birds were extinct 65 million years ago. That's a time span, if I do the math right, of about 165 million years. That's a lot of time to accumulate dead bodies. But no one buried dinosaurs. They died, they were scavenged, they decomposed, they rotted, their remains disappeared. Dinosaurs were recycled. Today's landscape is not littered with the bodies of squirrels and possums and raccoons. Today's landscape, for the most part, you can't find a dead body, unless it's one that was just hit by a car or something like that. Walk in the woods, see how many dead bodies you find. Walk through a field, see how many dead bodies you see. Decomposition happens, and it happens with impressive efficiency. Nature doesn't put much to waste. That's true now. It was true throughout the Mesozoic Era, which is the time when the dinosaurs lived. But not always entirely. Remember that dinosaurs were made up of flesh and bone. Dinosaurs were organic matter, but they had a lot of mineral in them. Next time you look at a bone, look at it hard. Ask yourself, why is it a bone? It's alive tissue when it's in your body. It's alive tissue when it was in a dinosaur's body. But a bone is actually very highly mineralized. It has lots of phosphorus. It has lots of calcium. Bacteria don't eat phosphorus and calcium very much. They eat the gooey matter in the animal, the muscle, the sinew, the fat. They don't eat phosphorus. They don't eat calcium. They don't eat teeth. Bone and teeth are the most mineralized of any of the tissues in our body, and certainly of dinosaurs as well. Therefore, we tend to leave skeletons. We don't leave stomachs, we don't leave lungs, but we do leave skeletons. And some of those skeletons, if they get buried, can last for millions and millions of years. Earth changes. Skeletons that have been buried for many millennia can suddenly come to the surface just through the process of the erosion of rocks. Rocks can erode because of rivers, can erode because of wind scouring. There are lots of reasons why dinosaur bones can come to the surface. Then, of course, there has to be a paleontologist there to see them. Probably for as long as there have been people, there have been dinosaur bones popping to the surface, and some people notice them and some people don't. Dinosaurs really present us with the ultimate in forensic science. Think about it. We have to recreate lost lives, lives millions of years old, recreating an animal that no one has ever seen, and no one ever will see it, at least as far as humans are concerned. Consider what the dinosaur database is. We call it the fossil record. From the fossil record, we can compare dinosaur anatomy with the anatomy of existing animals. We can look for similarities and look for differences. We can compare the movement of dinosaurs as it might have been with the movement of the animals we see today. But we have to bear in mind that dinosaurs often leave just fragmentary remains. It's not like digging up your Uncle Earl. You might find an arm here, part of a skull there. You might find a femur, some vertebrae, part of the hip. These may be warped from all the time they've been in the ground. They may be broken. They may be shattered. A lot of reconstructing of fossils is like putting puzzles together. Puzzles that are three-dimensional in nature, puzzles where you don't have all the parts. Now, let's think about what a fossil is and how a fossil forms. Would you know a fossil if you saw one? Suppose you went into your backyard and started digging around, and you started finding things. Would they be fossils? Suppose you found a seashell, for instance. Is that a fossil? How would you know? Well, it's not such an easy question to answer. And so, being good scientists, we've pretty much put an arbitrary answer on it. A fossil is anything that has been in the ground longer than 10,000 years. That's the definition. So if it's been there longer than 10,000 years, no matter what it is, we call it a fossil. The name fossil, incidentally, refers to being buried. That makes everything we find in the ground about dinosaurs a fossil, because dinosaurs went extinct 65 million years ago. So now we have to ask ourselves, what factors killed dinosaurs? Why did dinosaurs die as individuals, and how did their fossils form? Well, old age is, of course, something that can kill an animal, but it's not likely that too many dinosaurs lived to old age. It's not likely that most creatures in the wild lived to old age. Old age requires health care, and they didn't have it. So illness or infection could kill dinosaurs. Did dinosaurs really get sick? Did they really get infections? You bet they did. Everything does. And when we look at dinosaur bones, we often find injuries that suggest that these dinosaurs have suffered from massive infections. Dinosaurs didn't have Tylenol, but they certainly could have used it. And some of these infections certainly killed them. Predation. We always see nature films where something is chasing something else. That's always been the case ever since predators evolved. So predation was probably a very important component of dinosaur mortality. And I'm not just talking about things like the plant eaters. Predators also preyed on other predators. Probably the biggest threat to a Tyrannosaurus rex was a bigger Tyrannosaurus rex. Injury. Dinosaurs are heavy creatures. What happens if a dinosaur falls down? What happens if something that weighs 5 or 6 tons or 50 or 60 tons falls down? What happens is it can get hurt. And we see many indications of dinosaurs with bones broken, bones healed, bones that healed badly. And finally, accidents. A dinosaur can be having a perfectly normal day when the floodplain it's walking in floods. It's swept up in the flood, it drowns, it's deposited, and then it becomes a fossil. So there are lots of things that can kill animals, and those are the things that killed dinosaurs. What happened when a dinosaur died? Pretty much the same thing that happens when a raccoon dies. Initially, it just lays there dead. But then the bacteria start working on it. It starts to bloat as the bacteria in its intestinal system are reproducing and putting out a lot of gas in the process. Scavengers come along. Lots of different kinds of scavengers. They dismember the corpse, start pulling it apart. This is one of the reasons we don't find dinosaur skeletons well articulated in many cases, because they're ripped apart after the animals have died. All of this is pretty normal, and it usually results in a corpse being totally disposed of, not a fossil being formed. But what happens if there's accidental burial? Suppose the raccoon that gets run over by a car gets swept up somehow and buried. What might happen then? If there's accidental burial, it prevents the final process of decomposition. It may, in fact, keep the fossil in a form that is relatively undecomposed, almost articulate. That means that we can see its anatomy really well. A lot of dinosaurs, for instance, are found with their necks arched back over their backbone. This is called the death posture for dinosaurs. I'm going to talk about that a bit later in the course, but for now, just know that that's a very common posture to find dinosaurs in, and paleontologists love to find that because it usually means the skeleton is reasonably well articulated. They can look at the skull, the neck, the backbone, the ribs, the hips, everything. Sometimes we find dinosaur fossils in large numbers, almost like a bone bed. It's as though we found a dinosaur cemetery. And it's hard to know what created this kind of mass of bones in one place. Think about what might do that. Suppose the animals died, for instance, along a floodplain, rivers swelled with seasonality, the bones were washed with some force down to where eddy currents came in, and they were deposited one after another, year after year after year, as seasonal floods occurred. That's one explanation. Another is flash floods. A herd of dinosaurs is grazing peacefully. They hear a strange sound. They don't know what it is. The next thing they know, they're swept up in water as a flood suddenly happens, and they're deposited in mass numbers. And if fossilization occurs millions of years later, paleontologists get to look at them. When we find dinosaur fossils, as I've pretty much made clear, we usually find bones. That's because of the fact that bones are highly mineralized and don't decompose readily. But sometimes we get very, very lucky. You can find soft tissue occasionally with dinosaurs, or at least the impressions of it. There's even a dinosaur that was reported some years ago as having the impression of its heart still in its chest cavity. More commonly, we don't find that, but we sometimes find fossilized skin. Sometimes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.